Thank you. Yeah. So last time we discussed the possibility to construct a stochastic differential equation for the system of the particles which move in the random media and interact one with another. So the picture can be imagined as follows. Here we have some particles. They move randomly, and also there exists interaction between them. And so on. So all this system moves, one can say, together. We discussed that this interaction between particles can be described by including into the coefficients of the stochastic differential equation of the mass distribution of all particles. Today, we will start from the such equation, consider formal description of this equation, consider theorem of the existence of the solution and its properties. Then we will go further to consider not arbitrary system of the particles, but for example, if we have some curve which is placed in the floor, or some manifold which is placed on the floor, and we will discuss its behavior. Let us start from the equation. Since the our system of the particles can be rather big, the number of the particles can be rather big, even it can be uncountable, then it is useful and convenient just to say that we consider particles which start from any point of the space. So I will consider the following equation. Where we start from any point of the space, the initial time, and there exists initial distribution of the mass mu zero, such that mu t is equal to mu zero image of x minus one. So we have such system of stochastic differential equations. Let me say a few words about this notation. This notation exactly means that mu t from some set A is equal to mu zero of such points u that x u t belong to A. For example, if we consider just two particles with the mass m1 and m2, then our place the points u1 and u2, then our initial mass distribution mu0 formally can be written as m1 delta u1 plus m2 delta u2. And when these particles began to move, and at the time t have a position x u to t, x u1 t. They keep their mass, so they still have m1 and m2. Then I can say that mu t in this example is equal m1 delta x u1 t plus m2 delta x u2 t. We just carry the mass along the flow. What is important that mass distribution comes inside of the coefficients. Here it causes some new difficulties. For example, usually we have such opinion that if some differential equation have coefficients which are Lipschitz, which respect to the unknown function, in our case x, then solution is unique and exists. But now you see two difficulties, new respectively usual stochastic differential equation. The first one is formal. At least here we have new variable inside of the coefficients. So we have to understand what it means Lipschitz condition with respect to this variable, and does it work or not. The second one is much more deeper, because you see this mu t, which is inside of the coefficient, can be expressed in terms of the flow x. But to know mu t, we need to know not x for fixed starting point, but for all space. Then we understand how mu zero is translated into mu t. So here just producing infinitesimal increments of the motion for x u t, we have to do to proceed as follows. First of all, we define x for all u up to the moment t, then calculate mu t, then substitute it there, and then calculate this infinitesimal increment. So this is a program, and we face these two new difficulties. So I will show you how to overcome these difficulties. The first one is more or less formal and technical. This is a description of the dependence of our coefficients from the measure mu t. As you see from the definition, the total mass of the our particles does not change. For example, if this total mass will be equal is equal to one, it remains to be equal one during all time. This causes us to introduce the space of probability measures. So I will denote by M0 is a space of all probability measures. Measures on RD, of course, on the Borel sigma field of RD. And we have to introduce here distance. Because I say probability measures just for convenience, because it is there are no any reasons to switch for measures of total mass equal to 2 or 5 or some other number. Just for convenience, take the total mass equal to 1. Then we have such a set of measures, and to make this set to be metric space, we need to define the distance. And distance there came actually from the notion of weak convergence, but let me define it formally. Then we will discuss it a little bit. I will discuss a Wasserstein distance. And this distance can be defined formally as follows. Consider two measures mu and nu, which belongs to M0. If I consider the product space, here is RD, here is RD, then I can discuss on this product space such probability measures kappa on D square, such that its marginal projections onto this space, onto this space, coincide with mu and nu. So that projections of kappa are equal mu and nu. By the way, such kappa always exists. For example, I can take kappa equal mu multiplied by mu. And it is useful to understand that in general, the set of such kappa is rather big. This is not the unique choice of such kappa. And then I will denote by Q mu nu. This is the set of all such kappa. And then finally define the distance gamma zero between mu and nu, like the infimum under the kappa belong q mu nu, infimum of the such integral. Integral, double integral with respect to RD. Here is norm u minus v, 1 plus norm u minus v, kappa du v. Here is the definition of the Wasserstein distance between probability measures on the space RD. From the first look, this is a rather complicated definition, but it can be checked that mu zero with gamma zero is now complete separable metric space. It will be a good exercise, but I must say that this is not easy exercise to check this statement. By the way, this is not a unique choice of the distance between probability measures. Of course, you can imagine a lot of different choices. For example, distance by variation. Yes, but you see, if we will walk with the distance by variation, our space became to be very big. It will be non-separable, of course, because the distance between any two delta measures is equal to two. Yeah, and in this case, it is hard to walk with it. So we must have such distance that is related to some good and already known properties of the probability distributions on RD. And actually, this distance is very well known for us. This is the distance of the weak convergence. It can be also proved that the convergence in this distance is exactly weak convergence of the probability measures on RD. So from this point of view, it is rather good. It is rather good distance. And it can be modified. For example, one can consider not only the set of all probability measures mu zero, but one can consider the set MP. It will be for P greater or equal to one. And it will be a set of all probability measures which have finite this moment of the norm, yeah. Such that the integral with respect to RD norm of u power mu du is finite. It's finite. Then, in this set, one can define the distance gamma p. It is easy, so I can do it just erasing something here. Gamma p will be equal infima of the integral, and here, of course, the norm u minus v in p power, and here one over p. Yeah, so it will be gamma p, and the same can be stated here. We just put P and say that it is again separable metric, complete separable metric space. What is now the convergence in this space? It also can be easily understood. Now it is the same weak convergence, but with bounded P moment. So you see that we can say that we have a good distance between probability measures on the space RD. Now let's come back and ask what is the Lipschitz condition on the probability measure valued variable. Of course, everybody can say, oh, it is easy. One can say that function A acting from mu zero to, for example, I will consider this case R, but RD is obvious, is satisfy Lipschitz condition. If there exists uh, there exists such L greater than zero that for all mu and nu, absolute value of the difference a mu minus a nu so equal to a gamma zero mu and nu. This is a formal definition and everybody can produce it, but doing this we are very our behavior will be very similar to the behavior of the bad students of the exam. Usually bad student can formulate very precisely formal definition, but what they cannot to do, they cannot produce any examples. Exactly this is our case. After this formal definition, we have to produce good examples. And if we begin to think, it is not so so easy to produce at least one example of such coefficient. But we remember which kind of coefficients we need. Let me recall you from the previous lecture from where we take these probability measures. We need the coefficients which reflect interaction between particles. So we need such kind of examples like this one. A of mu must be equal something like this. This integral, maybe multiple integral with respect to Rd. And here is some kernel alpha k u1 uk mu du1 mu duk. Here is the example of the coefficients which we want to discuss. Because you remember in partial cases, this was the description of the interaction between particles. Yeah. So we have to understand when such coefficient will satisfy this condition. I will not consider general situation related to general K, because it is easy to solve it after we consider just one function, just k equal to one. Let's do it. I want to consider such partial case k equal to one, and then ask when such integral alpha one from mu du satisfy this condition. And actually the answer can be following. Let me put this here. Suppose that alpha one is bounded and Lipschitz. So you see two conditions, not only Lipschitz, but bounded and Lipschitz. There exists such a Z. I just want to show you this condition because it is interesting to understand why it happens. And the reason is following. To this condition leads to interesting consequence. It occurs that now there exists some C greater than zero, such that for all U and E from RD, we have such relationship. Alpha 1 from U minus alpha 2 from V will be less or equal than C, and here norm of U minus V divided by 1 plus norm of U minus V. You see? Here is the crucial step. It occurs that boundedness of the Lipschitz function leads to the following property. It satisfies Lipschitz condition with respect to such kind of distance. This is distance on RD. This is also a distance. Please check it. This is like exercise. After we check it, then we can proceed as follows. Since gamma zero mu nu is equal here is integral RD norm U minus V. Maybe kappa du dv. Then, for any kappa, I can take such kappa, q mu nu, and then I can write that a mu minus a mu, this is integral RD a1 u mu du minus integral RD a1 v equal. You remember, this is a set of such measures on the product space that its marginal projections are mu and nu. Using this, I can rewrite both integrals like integrals with respect to measure kappa. So it will be equal. The absolute value of the difference. Here I have double integral RD. And here A1 u kappa du dv. I change nothing because here I just add integration with respect to this variable dv, but this function does not depend on v, so we just take a projection which coincides with mu. Minus the same integral with respect to rd. And here a1 v nu kappa du dv. And now when I have two integrals which respect the same measure, I can combine together, put a difference inside of the integral, put absolute value inside of the integral. So I will just write there. And then say that it is less or equal than double integral RD absolute value here, not maybe here, I have to write alpha. This is a kernel. This is a kernel, alpha, alpha. Here is alpha 1 from u minus alpha, alpha 1 from v. And here we have kappa du dv. And now let's use the property of alpha 1, which we already mentioned. It satisfies Lipschitz condition with respect to this new distance. So we have, it is less or equal than some constant double integral rd. And here we have norm u minus v, 1 plus norm u minus v. And here we have kappa du dv. Yes. Now to get the desired Lipschitz property, we just need to take infimum with respect to kappa. I just recall you, in this calculations, kappa was arbitrary measure which has mu and nu by its marginal projections. So in this way, we understand that if we have multiple integrals with bounded Lipschitz kernels, we have good coefficients with respect to measure mu t. Now we understand that we can produce a lot of examples related to interaction between particles in our equation with interaction. Let me recall to you this equation in order to overcome the second difficulty which we mentioned. So this is our equation. And now we understand what does it mean that coefficients A and B satisfy Lipschitz condition with respect to the measure valid argument. And we know already a lot of examples of such coefficients. All multiple integrals with the good kernels are such coefficients. But now we have another difficulty. And this another difficulty is related to this definition of mu t. As you remember, this definition means that to produce infinitesimal increment of the movement of one particle, we have to understand all movement of all particles up to the moment t, construct this measure, and then came back to the equation. From this point of view, it is now not very clear how to use the iteration method to solve this equation. Because if we formally write the iteration method for this equation, what we will have? Let me just write the n step. Yes, iteration method. And on the end step, we will get the following expression. Dx n plus 1, for example, ug, will be equal to xn ut, or xn plus 1, it depends on how people like it to write. Here, mu n t dt plus the same B X N U T mu N T E W and now if one want to use iteration method, then we have to estimate difference between x n plus 1 and x n. Course we will use usual Ronald-Bellman lemma, usual Buchholz-Davis-Gandhi inequality for this part and so on. So all technique works with the usual serial stochastic differential equation. But except one thing, in order to estimate the difference between x on this step, we need to estimate distance between this one, mu n and mu n minus 1. This will be a new problem. How to estimate this one? Huh? How to estimate it? And here I will show you just hint how we can do that. This is the next mathematical trick in the investigation of the equationless interaction. The first one was to produce examples of the coefficients. The next one is to understand how to work with such measures. And in order to estimate the distance between mu n plus 1 t and mu n t, let us recall that these measures are the images of the same mass distribution. Yes, formally we start from the mass distribution mu zero, and one can write that this is the image of the mu zero under x n plus 1, and this is the image of the mu zero under xn. You see such equality. So what we have? We have not arbitrary general pair of probability measures. We have the measures which are image of the one of the same measure mu zero, but between the different maps. So one can imagine that maybe we can estimate this distance using estimation between the maps. And it is true, because now I just recall to you the notion of this gamma zero, the definition of this gamma zero, mu n plus 1 t mu t is equal to the infinite with respect to kappa belong to q mu 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 n plus 1 t mu n t and here we have double integral r d kappa. But now this relationship allows us to choose special kappa from this set. Namely, I will produce such kappa. Suppose that we have such a mapping. Here is R D square. And I take from this space the Excuse me. This is just RD. And I take from this space point U and map this U into the pair X N U T and X N plus one. Yes. This is a pair which belongs to the space R D square. Now I will just take here measure mu zero. Let's denote for a moment this mapping by F. Then I take here measure mu zero, and here I will get the measure mu zero F minus one. And this will be our kappa. Why it is true? It's also very easy to check. But after we check it, we can take here this special kappa. Let me say kappa with star. It does not give the infima to this expression, but one can always say that this is less or equal than, and I will here have just integral which is equal to kappa with star. But if we wrote it in this way, then using this definition of the kappa star, I can say that this integral will be equal. Let me continue here. Will be equal to the integral with respect to RD, and here is norm of X N plus one U T minus X and U T one plus X N plus one U T minus X N U T norm, and here is mu zero du. That's all. From this expression, you can see that all what we need to have a good estimation of such difference. Yeah. And now we can do, we can proceed by induction. Yeah. So this is another mathematical trick, how we can overcome the new difficulty related to the presence of the measure valid argument in our coefficients. So after this, everything can be handled, and one can state the usual theorem expected from the beginning, that if our coefficients satisfy Lipschitz condition, then solution existing is unique. So now one can modify a lot of this statement, taking the measures which have the finite second or highest moments, then modify Lipschitz condition and so on. But the main line of the arguments remains the same. Now let us think about the stability. I want to speak a little bit about the stability of the equation with interaction, because here we can also face some new effects related to the presence of the interaction. These effects does not exist for usual stochastic differential equation. So what about stability of the equation with interaction? Of course, this is just non-formal title, because formally about the asymptotic behavior of the solution to equation with interaction, but we understand what it is. Now, to show you the expected effect, Let me recall you very simple linear stochastic differential equation. This is the stochastic differential equation for Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. So it looks like this. I will consider one dimensional case, one dimensional linear process. And here we have minus alpha xt dt plus dwt. And I will suppose that alpha is greater than zero. Then everybody know that this equation has a solution which weakly converge to the Gaussian distribution with the parameter maybe 1/2 alpha. And it is related to stationary process, which is called Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. And I will write stationary process, yes, related to W, but now I just will suppose that W is defined on the all real line. It can be done using two Wiener processes. This one Wiener process goes in this direction, another one in opposite direction, and they are independent. Then the increments give us white noise on the all real line. So I will consider the stationary process related to this one, like this zt is equal to integral from minus infinity to t e minus alpha t minus s dws. Here is this process, and it can be calculated. It can be calculated that this is stationary process. So from the point of view probability characteristics, this solution is very good. Very good. Why? Because it is very close to stationary process. But let's check the trajectories of the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. And it can be good exercise for students who already study stochastic process, general stochastic process theory, that one can check that probability that zt is unbounded equal to one. So our stationary process, which is good in the sense of probability characteristic, is very bad in the sense of usual differential equation theory. One can check that it has unbounded trajectories, it has infinitely many zeros on the real line, and so on. So it is not a good trajectory for solution of differential equation. So it looks like this one. It has a lot of mountains. Then what we can expect when we consider the system of the interacting particles. So now let's come back to our equation with interaction. Let's recall it. Then one can expect that even in case of good coefficients, when we have like in Einstein and Beck here attraction to some point, for example to zero, then the behavior of the one separated trajectory started from some u zero will be like this one. It is unbounded. What we can expect for our measure mu t? Due to this, one cannot expect the stability for our measure. But it occurs that we can produce, we can have some knowledge about the behavior of the measure. Namely, one can discuss the behavior of the measure T in such terms. Let me formulate formal definition and we will discuss it. Definition. The family mu alpha. Alpha is the set of indices. Is shift compact. If there exists family of vectors u alpha. I said size that mu alpha minus u alpha, these new measures shifted on this new u alpha will be weakly compact. Or pre-compact in the space M0. Yeah. So you see what happened. We don't require that these measures are weakly compact. But we just require that we can shift every measure in such a way that this new family of shifted measures will be compact. Examples, you see the following. The one is artificial, but very useful. Suppose that mu alpha is a delta measure in the point u. This arbitrary point, arbitrary. Yes. Then this point can be distributed over all space. From this point of view, this is not a compact family at all. Yeah. But of course, we understand that now mu alpha minus u alpha will be equal to delta zero for every alpha. So it is a shift compact family. This artificial example gives us experience that this notion is useless when we consider the mass concentrated in one point. But if we just switch to measure which is concentrated in even two points, it can be useful. For example, What does it mean that such kind of family of measures, like this one, 1/2 delta u prime alpha plus 1/2 of delta u 2 prime alpha. Such family of measures will be shift compact. When it happens? And the answer can be very clear, because we know that such measure, that if we have a weakly compact family, the tails of the distribution of the mass distribution of this family must go to zero uniformly with respect to all family. It means that if we shift these measures, these points must travel in some bounded region. Yeah. From this point of view, everybody understands that this family is shift compact. If and only if supremum of the difference less than 80. So one can see that this notion leads to the to some properties of our system of the particles. At least maybe all the differences, all distances, pairwise distances must be bounded. Yeah? And it happened now that we can control this. And for example, if we have equation like Ornstein-Uhlenbeck, but with measure valid coefficients, with the coefficients with measure valid arguments, then we can say that the family mu t will be shift compact. So this is the property which we produce instead of usual stability for our equation. And I must say that the condition for this property are exactly the same as the condition for stability of stochastic differential equation. So if we have stability, then we have shift compactness of the related measure valued process. From this point of view, we see today we have seen different things. We have seen how to produce the statement about the existence of the solution to equation with interaction. And we have seen the next thing, which is related to new property of this solution. We have to check not stability of one trajectory, but we have to check the bounds of the pairwise distances, which can be formulated in this way. This way of shift compactness of the O family of measures. This is the end of my lecture for today. Thank you for attention.
Oh, thank you, Professor. Thank you very much.
Maybe somebody have questions?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Does any student have any question or comment? May I have some questions, Professor? My first question is that here we discuss this equation, the regularity. Here, diffusion term and the drift term is bounded and Lipschitz for the mass distribution. Mm. It also needs to Lipschitz for the state variable x.
Yes, surely. You see, the ideology of such equation with interaction is the following. With respect to the variable x, with respect to the space variable, we can apply any set of conditions which we usually use to usual stochastic differential equation. Because more or less under every such condition, we can control the distance between two solutions. This is the crucial step. Then, with respect to measure valued arguments, we just ask about Lipschitz condition. I must say that this is one of the open problems, how to make the condition with respect to the measure valued argument weaker than Lipschitz. This problem came from the difficult structure of this, not difficult, but complicated structure of this space and mu zero. Despite of this space mu zero and m zero and gamma zero is complex separable, but it is non-locally compact.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
So it is much more complicated. Is more complicated than RD. In some sense, it is infinitely dimensional. And actually, thank you for this question because it is very deep. We have a relationship between the infinitely dimensional SD and equation with interaction. So when we want to make weaker condition, to produce weaker condition with respect to measure valued arguments, we actually came exactly in the area of the infinitely dimensional SDE. Of course, there is a lot of machinery. For example, this well-known book of Doprato and Zapchik, but such books always relies on the linear structure of the argument. But here we have non-linear space. From this point of view, it is, there are some difficulties related to
that. Professor, I have, and my second question is, the solution XT has any regulation on mu T, for example, continuous or differential?
Oh, yes, surely, all these things already proved that it has a good version with respect to space and time. Mu T also has a continuous version in this space and so on. So such kind of things were proved, yeah.
So if we can use the variation of calculus, for example, for XT on mu T?
Yeah, actually, yes. But you see again up to this. And actually for stochastic flows, there is there are such guy like Ellis and Dupuis, which use variational approach to produce large deviations for stochastic flows. In my case, I have such a result with my former student, doctoral student, and Yelena Ostapenko, and we use different machinery. Maybe one can say that we use ETOMAP. Still, ETOMAP have a good properties despite of infinitely dimensional framework. and we can produce large deviations too, and we did this. But this approach which you mentioned, variational approach, can be used. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. So here the interaction means the mass distribution involved in this equation?
Exactly. Exactly.
Oh.
It is involved due to coefficients, and you remember basic examples which we consider. This is these are multiple integrals with good kernels.
Oh. My last question is here you introduce the stability. Here, what's the means of stability in stochastic science? It's mean square of probability.
Shift compactness.
Stability. Here, what's the means of stability? Is it in orbit science or the in stochastics?
Do you mean stability? You know, there are a lot of definition of stability in stochastic sense. And for example, case of Hirschhausen Beck is very good example. Yeah, it is not stable in the sense of pathwise behavior of trajectories, but it is stable in the sense of behavior of the mean characteristics. There are different approaches to define stability, and maybe Khasminsky is a good reference for different definitions of this this notion for stochastic differential equation. But now in this framework, I was interested exactly in the behavior of the mass distribution. So I just wanted today to show you a new problem. Of course, we can forget about the mass distribution of the solution. Just check the behavior of the one trajectory. Then more or less the same condition as in usual stochastic differential case leads to stability of this trajectory in the sense of mean value, variance, and so on. But if you consider the measure, it can happen. You see, you have two stationary processes, but we discussed that they are unbounded. It can happen that the measure moves like this one. And then again, so the mass distribution can be non-compact. You see, this is a new feature which we want to study for this equationless interaction.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So
you're welcome. Next lecture at Wednesday at the same time, and we will discuss how to move by equationless interaction, how to move random surfaces.
Oh, so thank you, Professor.
Thank you for attention. Bye for today. Have a nice weekend.